Welcome to Rock Arena. That's a little low-key rap to get the show underway from Bigger and Deffer, the second album by LL Cool J. As well as releasing two very successful LPs, LL Cool J has appeared in a couple of films, Wildcats and Crush Groove. More black music coming up with the latest live footage of Miles Davis. You'll see a detailed documentary on John Hiatt, the new Richard Clapton video, and Roddy Frame from Aztec Camera performs a song in the Rock Arena studio. But first, three tracks from Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me. That's the double album The Cure recorded in the second half of 1986. The Cure have released a fourth single, and this is it, the extended version of Hot, Hot, Hot. With three songs from Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me. Miles Davis is about to tour Australia, and he's always been a big part of all the changes in jazz for the past 40 years. And now, he's an artist who constantly changes with his times. In fact, he recently recorded tunes by Cyndi Lauper and Michael Jackson, and he's also collaborated with Prince. The band Miles Davis is bringing here could play anything, and they probably will. Here's the most recent concert footage. really is incredible. That's real goosebump stuff for me. Miles Davis live at the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival. Unfortunately, while I'm there this year, he'll be playing here in Australia. Actually, coming up in 2 weeks from now, we've got the Walking to New Orleans program, which is a most entertaining look at that city's music with Jules Holland from Squeeze. But right now, a song performed in our studio by Roddy Frame from Aztec Camera with his keyboard player, Eddie Kerlak. Roddy comes from Glasgow, where he began the band in his teens. Roddy recorded the new Aztec Camera album, Love, in New York with a set of American musicians. That, in fact, has added a more funky soul sound to his compositions. Roddy's currently working with a 7-piece band, which he'd like to bring here. However, that may prove uneconomical, so he'd opt for an acoustic version instead. We'll have to see. This song is about the old bus station in Glasgow, a sentimental spot for Scots.
There's a city asleep, shares its dreams and desires. Every wish that we keep will trace a line to other times, other places. Though the song of the proud thousand eyes never fall for defeat. Take a trip to reprieve every hour they leave from Kilimanjaro Street. Drink a drink to be full, and our memories spill, adding on as they pour from our Saturdays and secret sensations. Drink a drink to tonight. Whiskey words tumble down in the street with the pain that they cure, sentimentally yours. Just the hate in me.
Roddy Frame and Eddie Kerlak from Aztec Camera in the studio performing Kilimont Street from the new album Love. John Hyatt's latest album, Bring the Family, took 4 musicians 4 days to record. John worked with Rai Kuda, Nick Lowe and Jim Keltner, coming up with a very nice album. His background is in country music, and this feature follows his story from childhood to now.
Thank you. Central Beauty Park was 6304 by the Carolina Dock.
Here this afternoon, rock and roll all afternoon long. Keep it tuned.
We've been out for about 6 weeks and it's over tonight. This is it. So we go home tomorrow. my little town. I moved here because it was the nearest place that had, you know, some kind of musical deal going on. 1971, 18 years old when I moved here. Just a child. This is kind of a blue-collar area of town. My friend describes this area as white people with guns. Colorado, this was my old street. This was like the... This wasn't the first place I lived. I think it was about the fourth or fifth. This was when I actually had a little bit of money, see? I mean, like I was making 50 bucks a week instead of 25. I lived upstairs in that White House. See this outside the stairs there? Uh-huh. I lived up there. It was two rooms. I rented it from an old lady that lived downstairs. It's a triplex. There's a house upstairs and two downstairs.
We were the first radio station to play black music on a regular basis. We were the first power station. There were some black stations in the larger cities like New York or L.A. in the inner city, but you couldn't hear them out of New York or L.A. or Chicago or Detroit or New Orleans, as the case may be. We did it quite by accident. Some black students in Nashville came up to see a guy named Gene Nobles who had the show at this time. This was late 1946, after the war, and these guys were going to college on the G.I. Bill, and they brought up some of their music and asked Gene if he would play it. So he put these records on, and there were some boogie records there by Albert Ammons and Pete Johnson and guys like that, and there were some blues records by Wynonie Harris and Bull Moose Jackson, Roy Brown, and he played them. And all of a sudden, he started getting all this mail from all over the South, all over the Midwest, and nobody could read it. I mean, you wondered how it got here. So we figured it must have to be coming from a black listening audience. In the early 50s, I mean, we were just talking to people who really, this radio station was such a mecca for them because they could buy things, they could buy records. We had a little record shop here, the Randy Record Shop, became the world's largest mail-order record shop right on this radio station. Randy later had Dot Records. He started Dot Records with people like Pat Boone and Gale Storm and things like that, which he used to cover black records. Everything that, see, white parents wouldn't let their kids bring black records into the house. So Randy came up with this idea of having Pat Boone cover everything Little Richard did or everything Fats Domino did. And then he got the Fontaine sisters to do things that Ruth Brown or Laverne Baker did, and he got Gale Storm to do things that other black singers did, and this they would allow.
That's basically the whole story of pop music.
Sure. That's how, you know, you look at the charts today, it's 80% black music with a white person doing it.
This is a tune that's... I used to listen to this radio station when I was a kid in Indianapolis, and it was from Nashville, it was called WLAC. A guy named the Hoss Man used to have a little program. He used to play gospel records. Sometimes it was so good I had to turn it off because it scared me because these people got so intense. Inspired me to write this tune. When the road gets dark and you can no longer see, just let my love throw a spark and have a little faith in me.
Yeah, he got a lot of black in him. Sounds he could be anybody. Robert Jr. Lockwood, Sonny Boy Williamson, Muddy Waters. It's got a lot of drive in it for me.
And have a little faith in me. Have a little faith in me. Cause I've been loving you for such a long time, girl. Expecting nothing in return. Just for you to have a little faith in me. You see, time is our friend. Cause for us there is no end. And all you gotta do is have a little faith in me. I said of you, all I want you to do for me, girl, is have a little bit of faith in me. I said, hey!
Nashville as a city and living there, how did it influence your writing?
A great deal, I'm sure. I mean, there was a lot of interesting folks here when I first came here. You had Guy Clark, Towns Van Zandt, Chris Gantry. Things were happening in the underbelly, you know. And we used to all, you know, get together and play our new songs. And it was like a thrill. It was like, well, hey, listen to this one I just wrote, you know. And you'd hear a Desperado's Waiting for a Train, for example, and you'd go. And you'd go, oh, we better get to work, you know.
Well, you heard that.
It's inspirational. Absolutely, yeah.
Well, he's a drifter and a driller. Oil wells, an old school man of the world. He taught me how to drive his car when he's too drunk to